morning, church. Welcome to the online church service for Sunday, February 21st for West Guilford Baptist Church. We're glad that you've come together with us in this format of online worship that we've been doing for the last little while. And so we encourage you to just get comfortable, ask the Lord to speak to your heart as we worship the Lord together. Here in West Guilford and in Haliburton County, we have gone from being in a lockdown situation, COVID-wise, to being out of that and into what they call the orange level. And the orange level means that we can start meeting together in a limited capacity in our church on Sunday mornings. We were there for a while before we got shut down, and now we're going back. And so I'm happy to announce that starting Sunday, February 28th, we will be having live Sunday morning worship services at 10:30 p.m. here, a.m. here at West Guilford Baptist Church. So we invite you to come to ask the Lord, and if he gives you a nudge towards coming, come and join us. We're going to do all the COVID-friendly things that we're supposed to do. We're going to have people 6 feet apart and washing your hands and wearing masks as needed. And so we encourage you to consider coming. We can meet up to one-third of our capacity. That's about 33 to 35 people. And before COVID, we were meeting with 20-some people. Now, not everyone will feel comfortable to come right away because COVID is still around. And we realize that, and because of that, we're still going to record our messages on Friday afternoon, like we are doing today, so that those who don't feel comfortable can go online to Facebook or YouTube or through email and enjoy the worship service whenever it's good for you, whether it be Sunday morning or whatever time works for you. Being in the orange area, the other two things that we're happy to say we were able to do is our kingdom prayer time is going to resume on Mondays at 10:30 a.m. in the sanctuary, large circle, 6 feet apart. We're going to gather and pray for one another, pray for the kingdom of God, and pray for the world. So we encourage you to consider coming to that on Mondays starting March 1st. And then on Wednesday, March 3rd, our men's small group that meets in the sanctuary in a very similar way in a large circle will resume at the church. So for men who have been attending, we encourage you to come and reattend with us. And any new men who are interested, if they could just give me a call at the church, 705-935-1470, and make sure that we have room. We're limited to 10 men to be able to meet together. Same with prayer. And so if you haven't attended in the past, we'd love you to come, but we want to make sure we have room for you. I think those are all the announcements for today. Our call to worship is found in Psalm 25, verse 1 to 5. Psalm 25, verse 1 to 5. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. To you I trust, O my God. Do not let me be put to shame, nor let my enemies triumph over me. No one whose hope is in you will ever be put to shame, but they will be put to shame who are treacherous without excuse. Show me your ways, O Lord. Teach me your paths. Guide me in your truth and teach me, for you are God my Savior. And my hope is in you all day long. Let's come and talk to the Lord together in prayer. Father God, as we come into your presence and recognize your presence with us, we want to do what your word says. We want to lift up our soul to you, lift up our arms in praise to you, lift up our hearts to you, and acknowledge that you are the one we trust. You are the one that our hope is in. You are our God, the one and only God, and we come to you through the blood of Jesus Christ, your Son. We come because of what he has done for us on the cross, and we thank you. Thank you for having adopted us into your family, chosen us. We are precious to you. We are your children, and we thank you. Your word says, do not let us be put to shame by our enemies, by those who maybe oppose you, but do not let us be put to shame by our sin, Lord. Help us. Cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Help us to stay away from those areas that we are weak in, to cry out to you for mercy and grace and strength, to live upright lives that bring you glory, Father. Show us your ways. Teach us your statutes, O Lord. Lead us down your path. We know that there is a path that leads to destruction, and we do not want anything to do with that. But our sin nature draws us sometimes, and we are weak and we are needy. So guide us in your truth. Teach us from your word, the living word of God. Oh, Jesus, you are our Lord and Savior, and we know that our help comes from you. And so we thank you for this opportunity to come together and to worship you. We ask that today, as we come and praise you and hear your word, that you may fill us afresh, Holy Spirit. We need a fresh outpouring of your Spirit. We need your Spirit to stir our spirit up to action. We do not want to be people of inaction. We want to be people who are ready and willing to say, Lord, wherever you want me, I will go. We want to stand firm in your word. We want to stand firm in a world that is not standing firm, that is going farther and farther away from the word of God and things you tell us are right. Help us to stand firm, Father, by the power of your Holy Spirit. We pray for the world we live in. It is a world filled with all kinds of challenges, but the world challenge of this COVID-19 virus that has been with us now for over a year continues to change, it seems, along the way. The variants that it seems are starting to be show up in different places. The fact that it's taking longer to get the vaccines out, all of these things can bring fear into our hearts. But your word says you have not given us a spirit of fear, but of love and power and a sound mind. So we stand on your faithfulness. We trust that in your time you will bring about a way through this and a way to overcome this virus. We pray for wisdom for the doctors and the scientists that are working on things, and for those who are getting it out, and the vaccine makers. We pray, Father, for guidance and humility for those who work in the front lines, that they will realize that they may know more today than they did yesterday, but they still don't know everything. And so, Father, may there be a humbleness towards those who are working in this area, towards our politicians, Father. We pray for them. You have told us to pray for those in power. And so we lift up the world leaders around the world. Especially we think of our Prime Minister, Justin Trudeau, and our President next door in the United States, President Joe Biden. We pray for them. We pray for those who work with them. We pray for our Premier, Rob Ford. Father God, use these men and women. Use them, Father, to help in this time of need. We pray for those who are sick with COVID, those who have lost loved ones with it. Oh, Father, may you help each one of them. Give persevering grace to those who are tired and exhausted from being in the front lines. And Father, we also come and we pray for those who we know who are sick amongst us, in our families, our neighbors, our friends. We pray for those who are finding it very hard to be alone during this time, the lonely, the depressed, those who feel that they don't have enough of what they need to make it through this time, those who are poor, those who are unemployed, looking for work, who have lost their jobs, those who are oppressed in any way, Father. We just pause now and lift up anyone specific that is on our heart. Thank you, Lord, for being so faithful to us. Thank you for always being there. you will never leave us nor forsake us. So we ask now that you draw us close to you and to one another, even though we can't be together this Sunday. May we sense the presence of the Holy Spirit and the love you have put in our hearts for the body of Christ. We pray this all in the precious name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Last week, we looked at what it means to be chosen by God, and we introduced a new song that was new to us and new to many of you. And we had a little bit of feedback that some would like us to sing it again soon so that we could get to know the song better and worship through that song. So we've decided to use it as special music today. And so may you be blessed and may you sing praises to God as we look at this new song, Chosen by God.
Walked in trespass and sin, lost without hope in this world, rebellious and so unaware of our need, estranged from the promise of God. By your grace we have been adopted and sealed, your Spirit abiding in us, your kindness expressed in the death of your Son, redeemed by his blood we are healed. We were dead in our sin, by your grace through Christ we live.
And there's beauty that I didn't choose you, you chose me to live for the praise of your glory. Faultless in your eyes and holy, I will walk with you, my Lord.
Lord, give us wisdom, enlighten our eyes, guide us to walk in your truth. Teach us to hope in a future unseen, the promise for all who believe.
We were dead in our sin, by your grace through Christ we pray.
God not only chooses us to be in his family, but he also equips us and calls us to serve him in different areas with the gifts that he has given us. Brody and Deidre Haight are E3 ministry mission partners with West Guilford Baptist Church. They've been here and worshiped with us and presented and taught. Even gave a wonderful seminar for us about a year and a half ago. And recently I've been in contact with them and asked them if they would send us a video update as to how God is using them and what they are doing during this COVID time. So we're going to watch that now together.
Hello, West Guilford Baptist Church.
Hi, my name is Deidre.
And I'm Brody. Some of you have met us and some of you haven't. We are from E3 Ministry, where we are part of equipping, establishing, multiplying churches, and evangelizing, sharing the good news.
So Brody's been being really creative in this season. He started doing more reflections, writing, and videos. So that's how we got this happening today. So he does Sunday reflection, Monday pause, we get some videos that we share about what we've been learning from God, and then updates on our friends in Africa that we did a fundraiser for and were able to help them out. If you'd like to receive the ongoing email updates,
just give me an email at brody.haight@e3ministry.ca. You can also feel free to follow us on our YouTube channel.
And we just wanted to share with you a little video that we did of an update on some of the things we've been up to
in this season. So here it is. Check it out. And we hope to see you all soon.
Hey, everyone. So we just wanted to give you another little update about what we've been up to since the last video.
So let's give a quick update. So last time we talked in the video, I was traveling across Ontario. We went on an RV trip. Mm-hmm. And the RV trip was crazy awesome. And I miss the guys I went with, because when we were together, there was such unity and brotherhood.
Yeah.
So we're praying for another RV trip across Canada.
So you chatted about the race that was coming up.
Yes. So the race is over and we raised $15,090, which came in right at the end of the 100K. So we are so blessed by that. And that money now is going to help the two orphanages for the next year. And we were getting so many updates from them. Some of you have seen the pictures, but take a look right here. They had an amazing Christmas party where they had goat and treats and rice. And oh, it was great. It was awesome.
They got to eat and celebrate. And it's because of your guys' generosity. Yeah. Thank you so much.
And not only that, it's going to go for the next year.
Yeah, which is so amazing. Yeah. So what is in the future for you, Brody?
Yeah, so you guys inspired me so much during that run. I was so encouraged right after that while I was recovering. Not that long. Maybe it was a day's sleep. And then I was back out there running. Yeah, my recovery is running. So anyways, the Holy Spirit spoke to me and told me to continue to keep going. And from all of the encouragements and messages from you guys, that's what I'm going to do. So I have a big goal, and that's to run 100 miles by June. So that's my first year of running. We did the 100K from Elmira to Godrich, and now we will run 100 miles, which is 160 kilometers. Mm-hmm. So some of you have seen my training rhythm in the video right before this one, and it's going to be so cool, because we are going to raise not $15,090, but we're going to go big. We're going to go for $50,000 to raise support for the orphan. I've traveled around the world. I've done hurricane relief in Cuba. I've been to the back countries of Nicaragua. I've been to the refugee camp. And I just see the great need out in the world. Yeah. And this is what has inspired this new inspiration in me.
So it's called Life on Fire. Isn't that perfect? on fire.
Life on fire. So, life on fire. We're going to tell you a little bit about that more in another video. This is just inspiration from the Holy Spirit to give back to the least and most vulnerable people. What about you? What's going on? What's up?
Well, what I mentioned was I started my own business. Yeah, I'm still doing it. It's awesome. I'm enjoying the process. I have 7 voice students, which is amazing. And I'm looking for 11 more. 11 more students.
All star. And I'm taking, I took my first piano lesson and I learned the C major family.
Yeah, he's a good student.
So now I get to know that family, and I'm going to get to know the rest of the families.
Yes.
Because right? There's a whole bunch
the
of
scale
sets.
Families. Brody the named them families.
Yes.
Because he's very relational, and I like the way your brain thinks.
And maybe I'll get a quick lesson today.
Maybe.
I got a beautiful teacher.
You got to stay focused. So what I did is, since I'm building my music students, I also need to figure out creative ways, which God is giving me, to make income, because I'm an entrepreneur right now. So I did a Christmas gratitude tree set, and we did that together. We posted a video on Facebook of reading off the things we were grateful for. I did a New Year's gratitude set, and exciting news is I'm going to do a Valentine's Day What I Love About You set. So,
P.S. favorite holiday? I don't know what it is. But
celebration.
It's fun. I think it's
Birdie fun. Birdie really likes it. The celebration of love.
This is a feather from her leg.
I'm getting distracted. It is. But yeah, so I'm selling What I Love About You sets for Valentine's Day. I'm only going to have so many, so message me if you want to get yours. They're going to be $15. Yeah. So we've just been figuring out what the best rhythms of our life, I like the word rhythms because I'm musical, or harmony, of our life are. And what we've been doing is we've been getting up together. Well, you get up first.
What time do I get up?
5 a.m. A time I'm sleeping.
5 a.m.
And then
sometimes I get up at 4, but anyways.
I know. And then I get up at around 6:15 or so. And then we'll get up, put on warm clothes, and we'll walk around the block, and we'll just thank God. We start with thankfulness.
Actually, here's Deidre waking up in the morning right here.
Some mornings are easier than others to get up, my friends, and I'm sure that you agree with me. But we'll walk around the block. We start usually with thankfulness, and we'll thank God for anything that's on our heart that we're thankful for, the simplest things, that we can get up, that we can walk, that we can do it together.
And then we'll pray for you.
Yeah, then we pray for whoever God puts on our heart or whatever's going on. And I just find it, yeah.
Great way to start the day.
It connects us, like, to God. It gets us, like, focused on Him to start our day, and it connects us together, which is really good.
And one thing that I implemented is, I did it today, actually. I wake up and I do about an hour of silence. It's very quiet. I do an hour of stretching, but then today, I didn't listen to anything. It's nice to wake up and not check your phone right away and check your emails right away and just have that moment with God to connect.
Be still.
Yeah. So whatever that is for you, that's what it looks like for me.
Yeah. And then we also have been doing, we've probably mentioned it before, but we've started really incorporating for the last few months a day of rest. And to us, that also equals unplugging. So we've been doing that on Saturdays. Mm-hmm. And wow.
Yes. Yeah. So if you try to message us, it's hard to get a hold of us.
On Saturday, we're shutting down. Yeah. But we're connecting and, like, having kind of a detox, I feel. It's like a detox of all the noise. And it's been really good. I've really enjoyed it. And I feel like it helps me work on being more present. So we just want to say thank you to all of you who have helped supporting in the run. We hope that you will join us in supporting for the run that you're going to do in
June.
In June.
June is the plan.
We want to thank all of you who also help in being partners with us.
Yeah, we have a lot of one-time partners and monthly.
Yeah, which is so amazing to just see. We were able to send out Christmas cards. That was exciting to just see all the amazing people that have been rooting us on, like, yeah. Cheerleaders, like, you got it, we believe in you.
Want to know more about the ministry and more about what we're doing? You can check the link above. We're always looking for one-time and monthly partners to come along with us on this awesome journey.
And we're just so thankful. Thank you so much, guys. Thanks for listening to our little updates. And love God and love people together.
Still for the
devotion is a very underrated, unappreciated characteristic for many people in 2021. Recently, I came across a survey of the number one qualities that people who are looking for a mate are looking for. And the top six were person who is sexy, romantic, honest, rich, adventurous, and what person who has a good sense of humor. They were the top six answers. Now, none of those answers are what I would call bad answers, especially if you're a single young person looking for a husband or a wife partner. But I was very surprised that in that group, none of them mentioned someone who would be devoted to them or someone who would be devoted to God if they were a Christian young person, a person who would be devoted to their children. Having been married for 41 years to the same woman, at the top of my list would be, I'm so thankful that I have a wife who is a devoted wife, a devoted mother, and a devoted person to her friends. She is a person of real devotion. And I think that is such an important characteristic for us to strive to have in our lives as disciples of Christ. This morning, as we continue our series on A to Z characteristics of a growing disciple of Christ, I want to look at the letter D as it pertains to being devoted to God and to one another. Being devoted to Jesus Christ and to God our Father is a characteristic that brings them honor. When we are devoted to them, they are glorified, they are high and lifted up. But it is easier to talk about being devoted than to live out a life of devotion. The Greek word translated devoted in the NIV, in the New Testament, literally means one who perseveres and persists and never gives up. It means to be dedicated to someone or some cause. Webster's dictionary tells us that devoted means to be focused on one thing, almost to the exclusivity of others. To be devoted means to place others' needs and desires above our own needs and desires. A devoted husband or wife is always wanting to please and help their spouse. They're always looking for ways to make them happy. Rather than doing the very least they can do, they're looking to do things that are perhaps creative or a surprise, something that can be helpful to them that they didn't expect. A devoted adult child wants to make sure that his or her parents are well taken care of in their later years and even through towards the end of their life. I think of my friend Laura Dill, who lives in Ottawa, who I got to know through her parents because her parents were friends of mine in high school. I actually dated her mother for a very short time before her mother and father dated and fell in love and got married. And Laura Dill's parents found out about a year and a half ago that they both had a tumor that was inoperable and that was terminal. Within about a week of each other, they found out. And that was hard enough news to hear, but then and they were separated and divorced and married to someone else. So Laura was caught, not in the middle because they had a good relationship, but she was the only daughter, one brother, and she was the one who God put it on her heart to make sure that they were well taken care of. And she documented that through writing and journaling, but especially on Facebook videos. And she did a wonderful job. Laura, if you're watching this, I want to tell you, your mom and dad would be proud of you. They were proud of you. And she did a great job of showing her love to them by her devotion to them, by being there for them whenever she could, day and night, by advocating for them, especially when they lost their ability to communicate. When they had no voice, she was their voice. And that's what a devoted person is. Someone who will be a voice for the weak, for the person who can't be a voice for themselves. And she very much was that and is that. A devoted employee can be trusted to give 100% when they're at work and to sincerely want to do what is best for their employer. They can be trusted to be as honest as anything. You can leave them the keys to lock up at night and never worry because they are a devoted employee. As a disciple of Jesus Christ, God wants us to be devoted to Him and to others. And one of the primary ways we show that devotion is through prayer, communicating with the Lord, praying and interceding for each other and for one another and for those who don't know the Lord. Colossians 4, verse 2 to 6 says this: Devote yourself to prayer, being watchful and thankful, and pray for us too, that God may open a door for our message, so that we may proclaim the mystery of Christ, for which I am in chains. Pray that I may proclaim it clearly as I should. Be wise in the way you act towards outsiders. Make the most of every opportunity. Let your conversation always be full of grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone who asks you a question. You see, this passage points us to the fact that we need to be devoted in prayer. We can't just be willy-nilly towards our prayer life. I'll pray when I'm really in a bad situation. I'll pray when I have time to pray. If you think you need to have time and be in a special spot and be in a special pose, either on your knees or bent over or with your hands clasped before you can talk to God, you've missed the point. God wants us to communicate with Him the way we communicate with our best friend or with our spouse or with our children. Just as you feel the need or as you feel led to talk to Him right where you are. Of course, if you're in the car, it's good to keep your eyes open when you talk to God. It's not good to kind of close them along the way. But otherwise, you can keep them open or you can close them if you want. When I go for walks with my wife, they often turn into praise and prayer walks, because the beauty of God's creation is everywhere. And often, she'll say, "What, did you say something?" And I'll say, "No, I was just praising the Lord. I was just thanking Him. Oh, what a tree. Look at that. Thank you, Lord." God wants us to pray for others, pray for their needs, but to praise Him as well. He wants to pray that we will make it clear when we have an opportunity to share His love, to make it clear and to do the best job we can, making the most of every opportunity. But always make sure that our conversation be full of grace. Pray that God will give you a gracious spirit, seasoned with salt, not afraid to say the hard truths, but to always do them in love. I don't think we are getting the right impression to people when we tell them about the love of Christ, grinning or biting our lips or kind of looking like our eyes are shooting daggers at them. That's not what God wants. God wants our speech to be full of grace, our conversation full of that grace. He wants us to be devoted to Him through prayer. Jesus is the example of that. Jesus spent much time ministering in the last 3 years of His life, but every day He made time to go away and to pray, to be alone with His Father. He talked to His Heavenly Father in many different situations, prayed for the sick, and raised up the sick. He taught His disciples how to pray. So prayer is so important if we want to be devoted to Christ and devoted prayer warrior. We need to spend time praising God and praying intentionally for one another. Not just, like I say, when we feel like it, but intentional. For me, that means early in the morning. It means before my day begins. I have to juggle things now that I have little children living at my place, having my grandchildren there. They use the downstairs for some prayer when they get up at 5:30 in the morning. And then they come upstairs when I get up at 6:30, 7 o'clock, and I go downstairs and use the downstairs. You need to be creative. I know that you young parents especially, sometimes you need to spend time with the Lord in the washroom. I've had many people tell me that. It's a normal thing. True devotion to others is an expression of God's love for them. In Romans chapter 12, verse 9 to 13, we read about that. Romans 12, 9 to 13, it says, love must be sincere. Hate what is evil. Cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Honor one another above yourselves. Honor one another, never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor, serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. Share with God's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. In these few verses, we see some characteristics that flow out of the devotion we have to God and others. It flows from love. It starts by saying love must be sincere. Hate what is evil. Don't be a hypocrite. Cling to what is good and be devoted to one another in brotherly or sisterly love. That means that we are to be devoted with a pure love towards each other, with a love that is concerned for their overall best and for their spiritual health. Honor one another above yourselves. Don't be lacking in zeal. Have a zealousness for God and for others, and keep your spiritual fervor. Keep hot for the Lord by staying close to Him and by being obedient to what He wants us to do. Be joyful in hope and patient in affliction. It's hard to be patient at any time. It's harder to be patient in times of trial, in times of affliction, and be faithful in prayer. Share with God's people who are in need. We're going to look at that a little bit more. But do we do that? How are we doing with sharing with one another's who are in need? This week we were blessed at West Guilford Baptist Church in that we received two large donations from one from a Christian organization and one from a Christian person who lives in Peterborough, who used to live in Eagle Lake, and yet this church, many years before I was here, ministered to her and her family. And in both cases, God put it on their heart to share with this little church in West Guilford because they wondered, how are you doing through the COVID times? Must be hard. Small little church, country church. And so they sent a love offering. Just touched my heart in both cases. God wants us to share with those who are in need. And sometimes that's us. God shares with us when we're in need. Sometimes when I phone people to see how they're doing, I ask them how they're doing, and I say, what can I pray for you for? And occasionally in the last 5-6 weeks since my daughter Buddy died, I've had one or two people say, Pastor Brian, I don't need you to phone me. I'm doing fine. I should be praying for you rather than you asking me how I'm doing. You know, like, I can't believe that you're taking time for that. But the truth is, that's what God calls me to do. God calls me to love those people that He's put on my heart, that I'm devoted to, those He's called me to be a shepherd to. The way I show love is by contact in one way or another. There's no physical contact anymore. Anyone who knows me knows I'm a big hugger, but I haven't been able to give too many big hugs to people. I love looking at people face to face and having a one-on-one conversation, but now they're at least 6 feet apart, often with a mask on. So it's much harder, but we need to continue to do our part. God wants us to. That's part of devoted love, is to show love to people with the gifts and the personality He has given you. For me, It means contact with people, even if it's from a distance. What does it mean for you? If you're not sure, ask him. Ask him, help me, Lord, to show devoted love to those people who you have put on my heart, not just to think about them, not just to pray for them, but to somehow, in some contact way, show them that you care for them, that you love them in some practical way. Perhaps the best-known passage and example of devoted love for one another is found in Acts chapter 2. Acts chapter 2, verses 42 to 47. The setting is that it is just after the day of Pentecost, and the church has just been formed in Jerusalem. And this is a new thing that God is raising up this church. And this describes the way they were devoted to one another. Acts 2, verse 42 to 47. It says this: they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe, and many wonders and miraculous signs were done by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. Selling their possessions and goods, they gave to, selling their possessions and goods, they gave to anyone as he had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. I'll tell you, of all the times in church history, this would have been one of the most exciting to be alive. It would have been a dangerous time as well, because it wasn't long after this that persecution came to the church, and the church had to scatter. That was one of the ways God grew his church. Sometimes he allows hard times to come for good purposes. We need to remember that. But in this situation, it was before that time had come, and they were newly filled by the Spirit. And it says they were devoted to the apostles' teaching. They were hungry to know more. They wanted to hear what the apostles learnt from Jesus. And so the apostles were there with them, and so they couldn't get enough. They had fellowship together. They met together. They broke bread together. They remembered the Lord together. They had meals together. They noticed who had need in their midst. And they didn't just notice it and say, oh, I hope that you get better in that area, that your need is provided. If they had more than they needed, they sold some of what they had so that those who didn't have much could have something. Boy, that's something that we all need to learn from. When is enough enough? And when can we share what God has given us with those who have need, over and above what he calls us to do towards tithing to the body of Christ, to the church, to missionaries? When is your neighbor who's having to go back and forth every day, perhaps, to visit their spouse, when is their need to a point where maybe you need to go over and encourage them with a casserole or with $30 to help with gas the next time? We need to say, Lord, help us to be like this early church. They loved each other. They were devoted to one another. They were praising in you and enjoying the favor of all the people because they had a zealousness. And it says that because of that, the Lord added to their number. Well, you know, in 2021, this little church in West Guilford hasn't seen too many people added to their number. We haven't even been able to meet together. We haven't had too many visitors. But we've had much contact with non-Christians through multimedia things, through our Sunday morning services, through Bible studies, and we've heard feedback that people are watching, people are listening, people are interested. About a few years ago, we had a new woman started attending our church and got involved in a small group, got to know some people, and I had a visit with that person. And they told me about their background and things. And when I asked if they'd ever been baptized as a believer, they hadn't. And so I gave him a sheet that we've developed called Five Reasons, Biblical Reasons for Believers' Baptism. And I left it with him, and I just left it with the Lord. This week she phoned me, and she said, we talked about several things. She said, the Lord has put it on my heart that I should be baptized. And I'm excited about that. This summer I'd like to be baptized outside. What a wonderful thing to see God working in someone's heart, even in a time like this when we haven't been able to gather together the way we once did. God is still moving. And so this is an example, this passage, of how God joined them together and they were devoted to one another. They had generous hearts. They had sincere love for each other. Ask God for a generous heart, for sincere love for one another. Today in 2021, we do live in challenging times as Christians and disciples of Christ. As I said, we can't eat together. We can't have community meals together right now unless we keep 6 feet apart from each other, and that's not going to make too many people eating together. It's hard to even meet together. When we open up in a few weeks here, we're going to be all, the chairs are all going to be set in a way so that we're only in our family units. It looks and feels a little bit funny, though many of us are very excited about getting together again after not being able to meet for the last 6 weeks or so. But because of the COVID-19 virus, many things are different, but one thing doesn't have to be different. COVID-19 can't stop us from loving one another. It can't stop us from being devoted to God and through that being devoted to one another. It can't stop us from doing the little things like phone calls and emails and texts and dropping off food or muffins or meals to the sick or those in need. It can't stop us from asking the Lord, how can we be creative in showing how much we love other people? I've mentioned today and in the past few weeks about my daughter Buddy having passed on December 30th. And when she passed, it was sooner than we knew she was very sick, but sooner than we thought. So we had to decide, what are we going to do to celebrate her life? At that time, 10 people could get together, and that was the maximum that you could have. And so we prayed, and God put it in our heart to have a service right here with 8 family members and a person in our family that's like an adopted mom and grandmother, and one person from Buddy's residence where she lived. Buddy had Down syndrome and lived in a community living residence. And many of those people, those 10, shared, and we filmed it and videoed it, and we believe God was in us doing that for us and for the community. But when we went to go outside, we were surprised. We had had the idea to get 34 balloons, one for every year of her life, and to let them go in the parking lot and to ring the bell, we have a bell here, 34 times. And that would be to honor her and to give thanks for her life. Well, when we went out, we were surprised that there were a number of cars in the parking lot. Apparently, the word had gotten out that we were going to ring the bell. And there were people who brought their own bells to ring their bells along with the bell. People who brought their own balloons to let their balloons up with our balloons. When we spontaneously decided to sing one of her favorite songs, Skimmery Rinky Dinky Dink, the people rolled down the windows and sang Skimmery Rinky Dinky Dink with us. It was so touching to see people who were so much in love with us as a family and with our daughter that they were devoted to come and do something special like that. On the way, when we left and drove down the driveway, unbeknownst to us, our prayer group, our Kingdom prayer group, had gotten together just a block away over at the community center, and they had someone who kind of sent them a message, they're on their way, and they lined up 6 feet apart, many of them having signs, we love you, praying for you. I'll tell you, I almost crashed the vehicle. I could hardly see where I was driving as I drove slowly past and people waved. They loved us, and we knew it. It was a devoted love. And God is asking us to be that kind of disciple, to have a devoted love for your family, your neighbors, those you work with, but especially for the body of Christ, especially for where God has called you to be one body together. Let's be devoted to one another. Let's pray together. Father God, we thank you for your word. We thank you that your word is convicting, it is challenging, it is encouraging, it is uplifting. And we thank you, Father, for speaking to us today through this service. So we pray that you may be glorified as we leave here today. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to sing one more song as we worship the Lord, and then as we leave. May the Lord bless you.
Thank you, Lord.